ओम स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। ओ रामकृष्ण द एस्टैब्लिशर ऑफ ऑल रिलीजन्स द एम्बॉडीमेंट ऑफ ऑल रिलीजन्स एंड द ग्रेटेस्ट ऑफ ऑल द इनकॉर्नेशंस वी सैल्यूट दी। इन द लास्ट डिस्कोर्स we saw that Sri Ramakrishna was very popular with all the people in Kamarpukur. He was liked by everyone, especially the women folk were very much fond of him. They would take them to their house and he would go into the zanana. So where the women folk only are there, other men are not allowed. So he went into the zanana also and see all the people, and people who could not come out, they would have a sight of him, vision of him, and talks with him. So there was one Durga Pain who did not like this. So he was boasting that nobody has visited the apartment or the inner part of his house where his lady stayed. So Gadadhar once, he just challenged him, I can get into your inner apartment and see all the women also and give all the details of your inner apartment. Then Durgadas Pain, he was a well established man in the village, said, let me see how will you do it. So that incident we saw in the last discourse. Women in Parda also were very eager to listen to Gadadhar, but they could not go to his house where Chandramani and other ladies used to be there because of this Parda system. So he used to go into their own house and then sing before them, talk to them and all that. He always had a vision of his future life. He would visualize how in future he would be. So two ideals presented before him. One, an ideal of a monk giving up everything and all attachments to things of the world and then live a monk's life. And second ideal was an ideal householder being absolutely selfless, devoted to God and helping people in every way, which his father was. Both these ideals used to come before him. And always he selected the second one, that is being an ideal householder to guide all the people. Then we also saw that he started a drama group in his school. So other young people also were very interested in starting a drama group. They all selected one garden, Manik Raja Bagan. There they used to practice drama. And then they became very popular. And he also learnt, Gadadhar learnt, moulding images, painting, drawing. Once one of his relatives' house he went, his sister's house. There, his sister serving her husband, he just drew a portrait of that one. So he became a very expert in that also. And at other times, he was just about 14, 15 years at that time. So at other times, he would take care of that motherless child in their house, Akshay, his eldest brother's son. And of course, he helped his chores in the house of his mother. This is how his life went on for 2-3 years. And at the same time, we saw Ram Kumar, afflicted by the financial crisis in his family, he left for Calcutta to make a good earning there. So he started a Sanskrit school there. So he wanted to take away Gadadhar also, who was anyway not at all studying in the village school. So this also we saw. Today we shall start and see the introduction of Swami Sharadananda to the part second, which we are going to start, need for the study of the life of a divine incarnation as a sadhaka. So he is going to now find out the different sadhanas that Sri Ramakrishna did before becoming so great a Paramahamsa. So we shall start this today's study. The study of the religious histories of the world reveals that except in the case of Lord Buddha and Sri Chaitanya, there is little detailed account available of the spiritual disciplines and practices of the incarnations of God as aspirant. God as aspirant. In the history of their lives, we do not meet with any detailed description of the indomitable zeal and unbounded love which they nurtured in their hearts, and with the help of which they proceeded to realize the truth in life. Nor do we come across detailed discussions of the surges of awe and admiration, of pang and pleasure, of hope and despair, alternating with each other, gripped by which they felt now elated, now dejected, though never allowing the vision of the goal to grow dim even for a moment. Further, we do not find either a natural nexus of cause and effect between their wonderful actions and behavior during their later parts when they have become great of their lives on the one hand, and the education and the actions and aspirations of their childhood, youth, etc. on the other. So the actions of the childhood and youth will lead to this higher development which we see, which has been described, but we don't know what they did when they were young, when they were children. Step by step, we do not know. The same thing about all the incarnations, almost all. For example, how Lord Sri Krishna, the darling of the gopis of Vrindavan, became transformed into Sri Krishna, the Lord of Dwarka, King of Dwarka, and the resuscitator of religion, is not clearly indicated. We don't get these steps as a young person, how he grew into a king and a great administrator and the rejuvenator of the religion. Only a fact or two of the wonderfully Catholic life of Jesus, of Christ, before his 30th year is known to us. Whatever is known to us is only after 30th year. He started sermonizing. Before that, how did he came to the stage? Perfection. We don't get the details. Only the all-conquering preaching peregrinations of Acharya Shankara are recorded. Shankara Digvijaya. There are several treatises, several books in Sanskrit describing the peregrination, the preachings of Shankara all around the country. But earlier, how it led the younger age, what are all the practices they did to reach this stage, we do not get. And so it is with all others. The reason for this is difficult to see. Perhaps those things have not been recorded on account of the excessive devotion on the part of the devotees. Devotees only record or keep the memories of them, and later on it gets recorded. But the devotees, because of their excess devotion, Nishardhananji says, perhaps they did not record. Perhaps they were hesitant to attribute human imperfections to divine characters, and therefore thought it reasonable to shut them out from people's gaze. Or it may be the devotees thought that they would be doing more good to men by holding before their eyes an ideal, the fully developed noble ideas and sentiments of these great ones, than by tracing the history of their superhuman efforts to arrive at them. So the steps they did not want to record, because there will be imperfection during the passing the way to success. So they will have some imperfections which they overcome. So they did not regard the devotees because of their devotion, excessive devotion. And therefore, they deemed it useless to place on record these endeavors. The devotees like to see their beloved master ever perfect. They refuse to admit that because they have assumed human forms, that is the incarnations, they have assumed human forms, any kind of human weakness or lack of insight or power could ever creep into their character. They are always anxious to see the whole universe inside the divine children, and not only are ever eager to read the experience and intelligence of an adult in the meaningless acts and efforts of their childhood, but would strain every nerve to view them as perfect embodiments of omniscience and omnipotence. So in the small acts of the child, it may be just natural act like any other children, they will try to read omnipotence, all-knowing, and then all-powerfulness, and of the universal love and tolerance. No wonder, therefore, they, that means the devotees, come to the conclusion that it is only in order to elude the eyes of men that the incarnations of God feign the mental efforts of spiritual practices and the bodily states of hunger, sleep, fatigue, disease, death, etc. Even in our own time, we have known many eminent devotees of our master, Sri Ramakrishna, having the firm conviction that his disease, that is the cancer with which he suffered during his last 2 years, was a feigning of this effort. It is due to mere weakness that the devotees arrive at such a conclusion. They do not like to attribute human efforts, aims, etc. to the incarnations of God, only because such a notion, they think, would harm their devotion. Therefore, we have nothing to say against them, but such weakness, it is certain, is seen in a devotee when his devotion is not mature enough. It is only in that state of devotion that he cannot think of the Divine Lord as devoid of powers. In course of time, when devotion matures and the love of God deepens considerably, such thoughts regarding the powers of God are resented as veritable obstacles to the path of devotion, and the devotee carefully avoids them from a distance. Earlier, they were not seeing the ordinariness of his childhood. He was just like the incarnations are like ordinary children. The devotees would not see when their devotion was immature. When it becomes mature, they would like to see only the human side of the incarnation, because the divine side is terrific. To see and be intimate with it is very difficult, as we see in the Vishwarupa and Bhagavad Gita. Bhayena cha pravijitam mahome. Arjuna says, I am trembling with fear to see your Vishwarupa. So the mature divine form of God is always, you look at it with awe, not with intimacy and love. So the mature devotee would see only the human side of it. You would think that God is my own father, my own mother, my own sister, like that, and would behave with him like that. All the devotional scriptures say this over and over again, that is, when the devotion becomes mature, they would like to see God more as man than God, because they could be intimate with him. We see that although Sri Krishna's foster mother, Yashoda, daily experienced the divine powers of her boy, she looked upon him just as a boy and fondled or chastised him accordingly. The gopis similarly could not attribute any relation to Sri Krishna, like Narayana, like the all-pervading Brahman, other than that of a beloved. in spite of their knowledge that he is the very cause of the universe, that is Parabrahma, instances can easily be multiplied. When the devotees of Master express their great eagerness to have some kind of vision as a direct evidence of particular powers of God, endearingly would he say to them, Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna, when the devotees would ask, no, we want to have the darshan of God. Darshan of God as what? As the Lord of Vaikuntha, Lord of Kailasa, etc. Endearingly, but Sri Ramakrishna, endearingly would he say to them, for such devotees who ask for such visions, Sri Ramakrishna would say many a time, ah, it is not good to have such visions. Fear will intervene when you see powers. When you see God in His glory, fear will come to you, love will not come to you. Feeding and dressing Him and the deep loving relationship of thou and I will all cease. Alas, how often did we not feel piqued on such occasions and think that He evaded our request? Very natural. Only because He would not bestow on us the vision. If, however, at the time any devotee took courage and said feelingly with a firm faith, your grace can make the impossible possible, so make us have a vision of God. If they say, please be compassionate and grant me the vision, the master would reply in an endearing tone, can I bring about anything, my child? What mother wills happens. Thus answered, if he would still insist and say, your will be the mother's will too, the master's usual reply was, my child, I do wish that all of you may have all kinds of visions. Spiritual states and visions. But is it fulfilled? Instead of desisting, even then, if the devotee persisted in his faith, the master only expressed his love to him by a gentle smile and an affectionate look, or would sometimes say, what shall I say? Let mother's will be done. But the master, although pressed so importunately, never tried to break that firm belief of the devotee and destroy his spiritual attitude. Many a time did we see such behavior on the part of the master and hear him say, ah, the spiritual attitude of no one should be destroyed. That means until one grows, one cannot digest the higher visions, God in all His glory. To get it, we must have strong nerves developed by constant practice of purity, holiness. Or until we are prepared for that one, it would be disastrous to have the higher visions. That is why, but as a guru, Sri Ramakrishna never said, no, you cannot have it. No, you will have it. Just now you cannot have it because you cannot digest it. So that he would put them off with all sweet language so that they don't insist on having the vision and getting themselves into trouble. Although not directly connected with the subject matter of this introduction, the topic once raised should be explained to the reader with reference to an incident. So the incident is going to go in detail. The power of transmitting to others truth, to others the capacity to realize spiritual truths by a mere touch or by willing, falls to the lot of very few aspirants. The master told us time and again that Swami Vivekananda, in course of time, would have the privilege of possessing the power and therewith do much good to the people. Such a highly qualified person as the Swami is indeed rare in the world. The master knew it well from the very beginning of their meeting and started molding his character and religious life in a special way by imparting the knowledge of the unity of existence Advaita, spoken of in the Vedanta. Accustomed to the dualistic mode of worship of the Brahma Samaj, of which he was a member, Swami Narendranath was a member of that, the Swami regarded the non-dualistic mode, Advaita mode, taught in the Vedanta as a blasphemy. That is, so that it goes against God, it is blasphemy, he used to say. But the master tried in various ways to make him practice it. Swami Narendranath does not want to practice Advaita. Master wants him to practice Advaita. The Swami said, as soon as I went to the Dakshineshwar, the master gave me those books which he forbade others to read. So Sri Ramakrishna would not encourage others to read the Advaitic books, but he would force Narendra to read them. Among other books, a copy of the Ashtavakra Samhita was in his room. When the master found anyone reading that book of the devotees who were not of the Advaitic nature, he would forbid him and would give him instead such books as Mukti and How to Attain It, the Bhagavad Gita or some Purana. But scarcely had I gone to him, Swamiji is telling, when he took out the book and asked me to read it. Or he would ask me to read some part of the Adhyatma Ramayana, which is full of Advaitic statements, which is full of non-dualistic ideas. I said, and sometimes bluntly, what is the use of reading this book? It is a sin even to think that I am God. The book teaches the same blasphemy. It should be burnt. This is Narendranath Swami Vivekananda's statement. The master smiled and said, do I ask you to read it for yourself? I ask you to read a little to me. Please do it. In that case, you will not have to think that you are God. So I had to read a little for him at his request. So he was being trained in the Advaitic way. Again, although he was training the Swami that way, Sri Ramakrishna was training him that way, the master was guiding Swami Brahmananda and his other devotees in their spiritual lives in various other ways, not in the Advaitic way. Some through the worship of God with forms, some through that of God with attributes but without forms, others through pure unalloyed devotion, yet others through devotion mingled with discrimination between the real and the unreal, and so on. Thus, although Swami Vivekananda and other boy devotees sat and slept, ate and walked together, and discussed religious theories in the company of the master at Dakshineshwar, the latter, Sri Ramakrishna, was training them all in diverse ways, according to their peculiar tastes and tendencies. It was March 1886, an incident he is now going to describe. The master at the Kashipur Garden was daily becoming weaker on account of the disease, cancer, in his throat. But he engaged himself with far greater and much more unstinting enthusiasm than before in moulding the spiritual life of his devotees, particularly the life of Swami Vivekananda. He did not stop merely with teaching the Swami the path of sadhana, path of spiritual practices, and helping him to carry the teaching into practice, but was also training him in something else, namely how to prevent the other boy devotees from returning to worldly life and how to guide them and hold them together, organizing the Ramakrishna Mutton Mission. So he was instructing. Every evening after dusk, he would ask all others to move away, call Swami to himself and teach him all this for 2 or 3 hours continuously, sometimes drawing him into a discussion From the words and actions of the master, it seemed to most of the devotees that he was feigning the throat disease in order to establish his order firmly and that he would be all right as soon as the purpose was fulfilled. Because he was talking for 2-3 hours and instructing. So other devotees thought he is only feigning the disease. Otherwise, how could he instruct for 3 continuous hours? As days rolled on, Swami Vivekananda alone felt in his heart of hearts that the master was arranging everything and preparing, as it were, to take a long, long leave of the devotees. That means departing away from this world. It is doubtful, however, whether even he was always conscious of it. Then there was a slight awakening in the Swami of the power of transmitting spirituality to others by a touch. No doubt he had felt that power arise within him from time to time, but he had not yet tested the truth or falsity of it by touching anyone that way. Still, in various ways, he got proofs of the truth of the doctrine of non-duality spoken of in the Vedanta and came to believe in it and tried to introduce that doctrine among the devotees, young or old, married or unmarried, with the help of reason and inference. There arose then a keen controversy over it, leading to sharp differences of opinion, nay, agitation among the devotees. For it was the particular nature of Swami to assert vehemently what he understood to be true and to extort its acceptance from others by means of logical arguments. Then the boy Swami did not realize that truth in the practical world assumed different forms according to different conditions and capabilities. It was the Shivaratri in the month of Phalgun. 3 or 4 of the boy devotees were keeping the fast with the Swami, that is the Kashipur garden. They had a mind to spend the night in worship and in keeping vigil. Lest the noise should disturb the master's rest, the worship was arranged in a small room built for the kitchen, situated a little away to the east of the residential quarters in which Sri Ramakrishna, the patient, was lying down. There was a fair shower of rain after dusk. The devotees were delighted to see in the masses of newly formed clouds flashes of lightning ever and anon, simulating the matted hair of Shiva. After finishing the worship, japa and meditation pertaining to the first quarter, pratham prahara, first quarter of the night, the Swami was taking rest and conversing with devotees, with others, sitting on the worshipper's seat. One of the companions went out to prepare a smoke for him and another went towards the residential quarters on an important task. Just at that time, a keen feeling of that divine power arose suddenly in the Swami, Swami Vivekananda. He wanted to observe its effects by putting it to test that night and said to Swami Abhedananda, who was sitting in front of him, "Do touch me for a while." He is telling to Abhedananda. In the meantime, the boy who had gone to prepare tobacco entered the room and saw the Swami sitting motionless, Swami Vivekananda, sitting motionless in meditation. And Abhedananda, with his eyes shut, touching the Swami's right knee with his right hand, which he noticed was rapidly trembling. A minute or two elapsed thus when the Swami opened his eyes, Swami Vivekananda opened his eyes and said, "That is enough. How did you feel?" he asked Abhedananda. Abhedananda replies, "Exactly like something entering into one when one holds an electric battery, one's hand trembling all the way." The other person asked Abhedananda, "Was your hand trembling by itself when you touched the Swami?" Swami Vivekananda. Abhedananda, "Yes, I could not keep it steady, though I tried to." So in spite of his trying, his hand was shaking when he was touching Swami Vivekananda, as if electric current was entering him. There was then no more talk about it. The Swami smoked Vivekananda. All of them then applied their minds to the worship and meditation pertaining to the second quarter, Dvitiya Prahara. So they went to the Shiva Puja again. Abhedananda, in the meanwhile, entered into deep meditation at that time. We had never seen him enter into such deep meditation before. The whole of his body became stiff, with his neck and head slightly bent. The consciousness of the outer world appeared to have completely disappeared for the time being. Everyone present thought that he had such meditation as a result of having touched the Swami Vivekananda a little while previously. The Swami also noticed that state of his and indicated it to a companion by a sign. After the last quarter's worship, that means end of Vishwa Puja, was over, at 4 in the morning, Swami Ramakrishnananda came to the worship room and said to Swami Vivekananda, "The master wants you." As soon as he was told, Swami Vivekananda went up to the master in his room on the first floor of the residential quarters. Ramakrishnananda also accompanied him to attend to the service of the master. No sooner had the master seen Narendranath than he said, "What is this expenditure with hardly any accumulation? Allow it first to accumulate well in yourself, then you will know where and how to spend it. Mother herself will teach you. Don't you see what harm you have done to him," meaning Abhedananda, "by injecting your attitude of mind into him? He has been progressing till now with a particular mental attitude, the whole of which has now been destroyed, like a miscarriage during the 6th month of pregnancy. What is done is done. Don't act so thoughtlessly from now on. The boy," that is Abhedananda, "however, is lucky that greater harm has not befallen him." The Swami said afterwards, Swami Vivekananda, "I became completely flabbergasted. The master could know that whatever we did at the time of the worship, what else could I do but remain silent when he scolded me like that?" As a result of this, not only was the old spiritual attitude of Abhedananda completely destroyed, but the new attitude of non-dualism, being difficult to grasp and assimilate quickly, was also misunderstood by Abhedananda. And in this name of non-dualism, he would behave like an atheist, sometimes committing improper acts contrary to spiritual injunctions. Although the master from then taught him the truth of non-duality and affectionately pointed out the mistakes he was committing in the day-to-day acts of life, it was long after the passing away of Master Sri Ramakrishna that Abhedananda, guided by that attitude, could rightly adjust his daily actions to that new ideal of Advaita. He should have got it after so much time after so much of sadhana. But it was prematurely injected into him by Swamiji. That is why he could not digest it. So he could neither hold on to Advaita, and he lost the other type of practices that the master was teaching. That was the crisis there. So several years it took for him to adjust to the new ideal which he had imbibed from Swami Vivekananda. To the class of devotees who think that the efforts of incarnation of God for the attainment of truth or the fullest manifestation thereof in life are mere simulation. Show, it is utter an acting. Simulation. Our answer is, we never heard the master express that view. Rather, we have heard him say, Sri Ramakrishna say, when the divine sports as human being, he behaves exactly like an ordinary man and experiences weal and woe and attains perfection by dint of personal effort, endeavor and austerity. So he shows the humanity how to attain to the higher levels through step by step. So if you just say it is all simply a sort of acting, feigning or simulation, so then the very purpose of avatara is destroyed. The history of the religions of the world bears witness to this. And it is clear that were it not so, the very purpose of incarnation of the divinity would be defeated. God comes to show us step by step the path. So if we say, no, it is only acting, so then how will you follow it? He was a God, he followed, he acted like that. We can't act like that. So, nadaiva charitam charet, in Sanskrit there is the adage, nadaiva charitam charet, don't follow the devatas because they are devatas and you are a human being. That will be our attitude to incarnations. That should not be. He has come just like any one of us. He struggled hard and step by step he overcame, reaches the pinnacle of Paramahamsahood, so showing that we also can tread the same path and reach the highest goal. The master's teachings to the devotees can be broadly divided into two classes. The reader will realize it when we quote a few of these. On the one hand, we find him, that is Sri Ramakrishna, saying to his devotees, I have cooked food, simply sit down to partake of it. The mold is prepared. Cast your own minds and get the form. If you cannot do anything at all, give me your power of attorney. So on and so forth. And on the other hand, he would also say, give up all desires one by one. It is then that you will succeed. Be like a cast off leaf blown by the wind. Give up lust and lucre and call on God. I have done all the 16 parts. Do not do at least one part of yourselves, and so on. It seems that our progress in life is retarded because we very often fail to understand the significance of the master's teachings and thus choose between free will and predestination, self-effort and self-surrender. They are not antagonistic to each other. Self-effort and self-surrender, they are not antagonistic. One leads the other. Similarly, predestination and the one's own struggle to reach their goal. They simply predestination, if you sit quiet, you cannot reach the goal. So they will come, we have to realize the true meaning of them and follow. One day at Dakshineshwar, we had a long discussion with one of our friends on free will and predestination and went to the master for the true solution. The master amused himself with our boyish discussion for some time and then said seriously, is there anyone who has free will or anything like that? It is by God's will alone that everything has always happened and shall happen also. Man understands it in the long run. But then something has to be added. Just as when a cow is tied to a post with a long tether, it can stand at a distance of 1 cubit from it or at the distance of whole length of the rope. So it is with the free will of man. A man ties a cow with the idea, let her lie down, stand or move about wherever she wills within the area. Similarly, God has given man some power, and he has also given him freedom to use as much of it as he likes and in any way. This is why man feels he is free. But the rope is fastened to the post. And mark this, if anyone prays to him in all humility, he may remove him to another place and tie him there. Or he may lengthen the tether, or even remove it completely from his neck. You see, God has given us some free will, and that is limited. Everywhere you cannot be free. Everybody feels we have a free will. Yes, we have, but to an extent. What is that extent? Until we follow the general rule of God, that the world has got certain values, we can't go against it. Our free will cannot go against the general law governing the world. World has to be administered by God. So, he has given us some freedom, for which, you know, we feel we have got free will. But that also depends upon him. Suppose we don't use it properly, like that cow, which instead of going, keeping the full length, we went on going round and round the tether and got stuck up near the tether itself. It could not move afterwards. Similarly, if we also misuse our free will, we will get tied up and we will be in a sort of a prison house. So, see, the author is stressing this point. Thus instructed, we asked, then man has no hand in practicing religious discipline. Everyone may say, whatever I do is according to his will. The master said, of what avail is it to say so? They are empty words. What avails it to say, there is no thorn, no pricking. As soon as you touch a thorn, you cry out, oof. If the practicing of sadhana were in the hands of man, all would have undertaken it. But how is it that they can't? There is, however, one thing. He does not give one more power if the little that is given to him is not properly used. Very important. What little free will he has given us, we must use it to go in the right path and take the help from the others, good guides in life. So if we progress that, whatever with that, whatever little will we can do, he will give more freedom, more free will. We can do much more things. This is why individual effort and perseverance are necessary. Don't you see, everyone has to make some effort, however small, before he gets God's grace. Everybody has to struggle. Prayer, japam, these are all efforts made. Not that the efforts will get you God, but we are following what is said. So he will be pleased, so that they are walking in the path I have shown. All right, now pull them. He will give us the strength, drag us to the highest pinnacle of success. When one does so, the experiences of 10 lives are crowded through his grace into one, and then all come to an end. But one has to make some effort. So this Sri Ramakrishna's great teaching, that we have to exert a little. So he also gives so many examples. He used to say, yes, it is true that butter is there in the milk. But if you simply say butter is there, can you get butter? You have to do something. You have to put the milk to heating, then cool it, then put some curd into it, and then it will curdle, keep it in a silent place. Whole night should go like that in the silent place. In the morning you will get curd, then churn it, then only you will get butter. So, though it is so easy to say the butter is there in the milk, but you can't get butter, you cannot see the butter, experience the butter until you take some efforts to take it out from the place where it is by through the effort. So some effort is required to know God. God is everywhere. In fact, He is sitting in our own heart. But we are not able to see because the little effort that is required according to what the Guru has guided or the Shastras have guided or the great people have guided. So if we follow that one systematically and by their grace, by the grace of God, we will progress and see God. So this is what Sri Ramakrishna used to often tell. So some more, many things are very nicely discussed in this chapter. We will continue in the next discourse. Niranjanam nityamanantarupam bhaktanukampadhrita vigraham vai ishavataram parameshamidyam tam ramakrishnam shirasanamamaha. O Ramakrishna, of taintless, changeless and infinite form, who has incarnated only to bless the devotees and who is the adorable God Himself, Supreme, we salute you with our heads down.